As you know, taste is also a type of chemo sensation. So taste molecules are actually chemicals that, when they bind to your tongue, are transduced into changes in membrane potential. And then the signal is carried to the brain where you perceive certain tastes. There are not as many tastes as there are smells. It's thought that taste is more related to understanding what foods provide a lot of energy. So sugar can be detected. Bitter, not all bitter things are bad for you, but poisons are bitter. So probably something evolutionarily relevant. Salt, also beneficial, a nutrient. Sour, and then the last one is umami. So unlike smells, where there's thousands of different molecules and different receptors, these are the five basic tastes. However, there are many molecules that like classify sugar. It's a affinity thing, right? So for a sugar receptor, different molecules can bind with different affinities. And that's how artificial sugar is able to stimulate these receptors and taste sweet, although it tastes a little different. So it is actually more complex. But we'll go through kind of these five tastes and how they are transduced. So that's kind of sensed. And then we won't talk as much about how they're perceived, but they're going to go to the primary gustatory cortex if they are perceived. So let's talk about some tongue anatomy, right? You know that your tongue is where taste buds are located. This is where we're going to have sensory transduction. So the tongue is actually covered with papilla. These are the bumps on your tongue. You can actually see there's different shapes throughout the different portions of the tongue. And on these papilla, there are the papilla are bumps, like just like your dermal papilla. Remember, papilla is basically a bump. There are taste buds embedded in these papilla. There's also some taste buds in your palate, the pharynx, larynx. We'll focus on tongue. So there are different types of papilla. In lab, you have the option to look at one type, the valate papilla. These are just different structures of the bumps. They do have different kind of proportions and locations of taste buds. So just so you're aware of that, filiform actually don't have taste buds. So there's some variety there. There's also receptors for pressure, touch, and temperature, especially on these ones, right? Because you know you can detect hot with your tongue. So without the detail of the different types of papilla, we are going to zoom into taste buds to see what happens there. One more thing about kind of the gross anatomy of the tongue is it used to be thought that different areas of the tongue were responsible for different tastes. So you may have learned, and actually my kids are still taught this in elementary school, that this part of the tongue is for detecting bitter, this part for sweet, et cetera, whatever. It's not true. This is found to not be correct. Actually, I think I have this pop up. In reality, there's different taste receptor cells within. So here's a taste bud within all areas of the tongue. Might be some differences, but so here, what I'm drawing is a zoomed in version of a taste bud, and it's going to contain sensory receptor cells that transduce taste molecules into changes in membrane potential. These are located throughout the entire tongue, and it's thought that sensory receptor cells for bitter, salt, sour, are located throughout the entire tongue. And potentially one cell could detect more than one taste molecule. So let's, unlike olfaction, the taste has two different mechanisms by which sensory transduction occurs. So we're going to zoom in to the taste bud. I just drew a really awful picture of one. Let's see a little bit better picture of one. Here it is. So this here is a taste bud. A taste bud is a group, a collection of sensory receptor cells, taste receptor cells specifically, right? And you can see those cells there kind of smashed, smashed cells all next to each other. Here's the nuclei. And then this is going to be the axons of these sensory neurons that are going to carry signals to the brain via various cranial nerves. So there's two different mechanisms for transduction. Just go ahead and tell you, one's a G protein, one is a ion channel. So for salt and sugar, I'm sorry, not wrong, salt and sour. So this is Na plus and H plus. Sour is acid, HCl. So there's hydrogen ions in acidic foods. So lemons, coffee actually contain HCl, and that H plus is what is detected. So these little molecules here are all positive ions, two different types here. This blue represents sodium, the orangish represents hydrogen. There's different channels for each of these. So let's say this one is a sodium channel, right? It's because these are somewhat specific, probably somewhat variable how specific they are, but it's a leak channel. Why can it be a leak channel? Well, it doesn't need to be regulated. When there's sodium on your tongue, you want it to be detected. Why does sodium flow into the cell? Down its electrochemical gradient. So here's our resting membrane. This is our membrane here. Hope that was clear. This is the like inside of the mouth, oral cavity. This is inside the cell, the ICF. This is showing over time. So this is going to be the ICF in this picture. So the result of sodium flowing into the cell is what? Here, the membrane is at rest. When positive ions flow into the cell, we have depolarization of the membrane. The inside becomes less negative than it was before. That's going to cause release of neurotransmitters. Oops, I can spell release. You know how that happens. Calcium-mediated vesicle release. Neurotransmitters, typically glutamate, that's excitatory. That is going to cause, so actually, can you see there's a separate little cell here? This is all happening in the sensory receptor cell. This is going to cause an action potential in that sensory neuron. The sensory neuron is a different cell than our sensory receptor cell because this is a special sense. Our sensory transduction typically occurs in a different cell than the cell that carries the signal to the CNS. Where's the cell body for these guys? It's going to be in a ganglia. What type? A dorsal root ganglia. Because this is sensory we're talking about. Okay, so that is how those ions, salt and sour, are detected. We're going to do the same setup here, but for bitter and sweet and umami. So this is bitter, sweet, and umami. These molecules are larger. You know that about sugar. It doesn't just enter the membrane very easily. So this is one of those molecules. Instead, it's going to bind to, what do you think? A G protein coupled receptor. This is going to be an active G protein. Here's our G protein coupled receptor, specific for whatever molecule is binding. There's a variety of, like for sweet, a bunch of different taste specific G protein coupled receptors. This is going to, actually, I'm going to draw in, I'm going to add one color here. this is going to activate the second messenger, right? That's the result of activating this G protein. Activate a second messenger, for example, CAMP, right? That I believe is, yes, that is the second messenger in sweet, at least. I don't know how much variety there is in other taste receptors, probably more than anyone knows, definitely more than I know. So regardless, CAMP can also cause a release of neurotransmitters. And same thing then, action potential in the sensory neuron. Let's see, I do have a more detailed picture of both of these on the next slide. So I'm going to go to that. So there's a nice image that goes over what I just showed you with a little bit of more anatomy. So you know the terms apical and basolateral. Here's our ion channel for sodium or hydrogen. Here is the complex stimuli. So this is our bitter, sweet, or umami. Ion channels, simple, cause depolarization, which causes further depolarization, and calcium entry for calcium-dependent vesicle release. This is example here shows serotonin. It could also, in some cases, be glutamate. It's something excitatory. Right, we have to excite this cell, our sensory receptor cell. For the second messenger scenario, same thing actually happens, just a more complex, indirect, a little bit slower mechanism. We have depolarization occur due to opening up other ion channels. We know that CAMP can do that. CAMP gated ion channels. Second messengers can also open calcium channels on the endoplasmic reticulum, similar to what happens in muscle cells. Regardless, depolarization occurs, calcium enters, and we have calcium-dependent vesicle release. So this happens in both mechanisms. Okay, last thing for taste. We've got our action potential in this sensory neuron. We're going to carry that to the brain. So we are going to start down at the tongue again. And taste is unique because there's multiple cranial nerves that carry the information. It's fairly complex. So here's our taste receptors. And we need to get those signals where? Up here to the gustatory cortex. Gustatory means taste, remember. So there's three cranial nerves, mentioned one in lab. That's the blue one here. This is the glossopharyngeal. The facial is the other main one. You can see here different proportions of the tongue are innervated by these different neurons. So like the front two-thirds and the lower, the back third. One more here that I'll just mention is the vagus nerve. That's a little bit further back, and then larynx, pharynx, et cetera. Vagus nerve does a lot, and we'll talk about it more in the spring related to heart rate regulation, all kinds of stuff. So then we've got that the cranial nerves are going to carry, oh, actually, I like that little added in there to remind you of what are these guys, the ganglia, dorsal root ganglia. Actually much closer to the brain, because in this case, we're not going to the spinal cord. We are going to the medulla. These are cranial nerves, not spinal nerves. This is the medulla oblongata in the brainstem. Solitary nucleus is specifically what it is. Going to then go to the, what do you think, relay station, thalamus, before going to the gustatory cortex. So how many neurons? One, after we get to our sensory neuron, I guess we could So our sensory receptor cell isn't really a neuron. That's a cell there. After that cell, we've got 1, 2, 3 cells, 2 synapses. So 2 synapses in the brain, and then its final location. Unlike most senses, taste is primarily ipsilateral. So it's going to the same side of the brain. Not super relevant because you're usually mushing things all around on your tongue. Okay, that is taste.